The idea of Sonder has become very well known on the internet recently. The term describes the overwhelming feeling of being in a crowded place and considering how every single person around you has their own inner world that is as complex as yours are. That they all have their separate experiences and ambitions, people they love, things they fear, lives that they lead. And I think it's quite a nice idea to consider. It makes me feel connected in a way to complete strangers, because there's a good chance that we've had similar struggles and experienced the same feelings at different points in our lives. And the song, Melancholy of the Literary Boy, talks about just another stranger in a crowded place, the kind of person who you normally wouldn't give a second glance to. The only difference being that this time we can see into his inner world, and we can hear him dealing with some extremely dark thoughts. The song covers the alienation he feels, the sadness and the exhaustion that weighs him down, and it's a kind of song that I think a lot of people can relate to. The way it expresses its message is really powerful. The music and the lyrics are heart-wrenching, and I wanted to talk about why this song means so much to me. The song begins with the titular boy waiting at a train station. He sits and thinks about his family, his friends, and his school and his job. Every connection he has to the world, and every person that he cares for. And he thinks about leaving all of them behind. As the train pulls into the station, he thinks about how he could abandon everything that he knows with only a single jump. The boy explains having these terrifying thoughts, but his voice remains calm and the music stays gentle. Thinking these things is something that no longer surprises him, no longer scares him. He's used to it. It's become common for these thoughts to slip into his head and wedge themselves into his mind till they're the only thing that he can think of. However, he is snapped from his mind by a girl crying out that she's lost her wallet and desperately asking people for help in finding it. But nobody stops to help her. They all have a train to catch. They all have places to be, things to do, and so none of them can stop to help this girl even if they wanted to. But to the boy, it feels incredibly cold that nobody in this entire station can give a few minutes of their time to help another. And the boy is no better. He acknowledges that. He finds it heartless, but he has a train to catch as well, and so he leaves the girl behind so that he can keep on going through his daily emotions. But as he gets on, he feels the emotions that had been creeping through his mind begin to explode outward, as the music rises from soft acoustics to pounding drums and guitars. The boy cries out, begging someone to say his name, to show that he is known, and that there is someone out there in this faceless crowd who would care about him. He remembers how they treated the girl just a few moments ago, and thinks about if anyone would even bother to help him. He asks why every day he only feels worse and worse, and experiences his darkest wish, to just leave this world behind. He fantasizes about rising into the sky, and watching all his worldly problems drop back to the earth, so that he can leave everything behind. But the thing about these cries is that they're unspoken. Throughout this part of the song, his face never changes, he never gives off a single emotion, and he doesn't even hint to the other people that he's experiencing anything other than boredom. And I feel like this is a realistic way to show how suicidal thoughts, and sadness more broadly, can strike. How for many people, it's just an everyday occurrence. It captures the feeling of wanting someone to help, wanting someone to talk to so that you can let out all the thoughts trapped in your head, but not knowing who to turn to. Sometimes out of fear of burdening your loved ones with your problem. Sometimes you worry that they wouldn't understand. Sometimes you're too tired to explain it all. And that feeling is even worse when you don't even know the people who are around you. He has no one to express this loneliness to. Nobody to understand him. He feels like an alien among this crowd. The boy feels tears welling up in his eyes, and he turns his mind to other thoughts so that he won't break out in tears. Even though crying would actually encourage the others on the train to come and help, the boy can't bring himself to be vulnerable to them. Even though he feels separate from those around him, he can't let the mask slip, because then they might all know that there's something wrong with him. What I think is especially interesting about this is that I think a lot of people on the train could really relate to him here. Many of us know that feeling of isolation, that contradiction between being surrounded by people yet feeling utterly alone. And if they could hear his thoughts, I believe that people would sympathize. I think that many people could understand what he's going through, and that at least one person would try to let him know that he's not alone. But the boy can't express his feelings. After all, reaching out to a complete stranger on a train is an extremely daunting thing, so the people around him remain as faceless shadows, and the boy continues to feel that alienation from others, because he just can't talk to them about what he's going through. But it's here that we're introduced to someone who can understand, because the boy shifts his thoughts to his favourite writer, a man named Osamu Dazai. Dazai is best known for his final completed work, No Longer Human. This book is a semi-autobiographical story about a young man named Oba Yozo, and the book describes how Oba spends his whole life feeling entirely alienated from the rest of humanity, how he acts as though he's happy, and acts as though he's a well-adjusted young person, but on the inside, he feels utterly empty. Throughout the plot, he repeatedly tries to form a real connection with the world around him, but every time he seems to have something he cares about, he falls, again and again, back into depression and loneliness. And at the end of the story, he's left with nobody, having driven everyone away and truly severing himself from humanity. It's a deeply harrowing read, and as a semi-autobiographical story, it strongly parallels Dazai's life in many ways. Oba Yozo is a stand-in for Osamu Dazai, and the tragedy of the story is only compounded by the fact that Dazai himself committed suicide not long after the book's completion. I think that the boy here kind of parallels Oba and Dazai. He looks up to Dazai immensely, because he sees the man as the only person who understands what it feels like to be alone in the world. Escaping into Dazai's words are some of the only times he actually feels heard, and in that way, Dazai is almost like a friend to him. Even if nobody on this train can help him, at least he has Dazai. But at the same time, he knows that's not really true. Dazai died decades before he was even born, and he knows he's clinging onto the words of someone who he never really knew. And to an extent, that just makes him feel even worse. During the song, he describes how, after reading about Dazai's suicide, he was unable to get the idea of suicide out of his head. Reading this man's work brings him comfort, but it also immerses him in that misery. He can't talk to Dazai, he doesn't really know him. All he can do is ruminate upon the darkest emotions that Dazai printed on the page, and in a way, this is only making him feel worse. Maybe I'm reading way too deeply into this, but I feel like this speaks to how media that is upsetting can both help and hurt us, because this song is the song that I go to when I feel miserable. The music is beautiful, and the lyrics capture so many of my own feelings of sadness and alienation, and I can forget my problems for a while listening to this song. Vocaloid is unique in how candidly it portrays emotions. It takes subjects that are normally taboo and openly talks about them with a level of empathy that is not often seen in other media. It's developed into a beautiful thing, where creators feel able to channel their negative emotions into art, and it's become equally therapeutic for many to hear their frustrations echoed by the music that they're listening to. And just like how the boy felt understood when he read about Oba, we too can feel understood when we hear a song that encapsulates our darkest emotions. But at the same time, I think I also use the song to hurt myself. I know that sounds dumb, but what I mean is that sometimes I've allowed the melancholy in the song to overwhelm me, to drag me deeper into sadness. Even though I started listening so that I could feel understood, I've just made myself even more upset. If I listen to the song for too long, then the heart-wrenching music begins to get to me, and the boy's pain becomes something that I can't get out of my mind. Media like this, the kind that tackles these topics, is incredibly important for letting people know that they're not alone. This song means a lot to me, and reading the comments in the video, I can tell that others feel the same. In a world where it's terrifying to talk about negative emotions, this song helps you know that it's okay to feel how you do, and I think that helps a lot, but sometimes I drown myself in the sadness. If I listen to it for too long, it envelops me in sorrow. There's absolutely a time to listen to this music, but I do need to remind myself that I need to turn it off after a while. I don't know if that's something that many other people experience, but that's a lot of what the song has become to me. It's been playing in my ears while I was going through some pretty dark shit, and I'll always be grateful to it for that. But I know that there's a time when I need to pull the earphones out and get back up again. Near the end of the song, the boy calls out to Dazai, not to his family or his friends, but just to Dazai. And he wonders if he'll meet the same end as the author he loves. He imagines once again that everyone would just vanish, and that the train carriage would rise into the sky, so that he'd be out of the grasp of anguish. He wonders if he should just die. And in his mind, he stands at the door of the carriage, wondering whether he should jump, wondering if he should end it all. But in the final scene, we see him one last time, as an old man, once again waiting at the train station. This ending is ambiguous. We don't know exactly what he's feeling as an old man. This time we aren't given access to his thoughts. But I honestly like this ending. We know that whatever happened back then, the boy survived. Maybe he did try to commit suicide. Maybe he didn't. We don't know. We don't know what his life has been like, whether he's found people he could talk to, whether he's been able to achieve happiness. In the end, this song is just one snippet of his life. But the important thing is that he survived. Despite all the sadness, all the alienation, he's still there. And I think that's an optimistic ending. If I can be self-indulgent again, there have been brief periods in my life where I felt just like the boy. I think most people have too. Maybe not to the same extent, but many of us have been there. So it means a lot to think that he managed to get through this and managed to be happy. I feel so much better now than I did back in those brief periods of sadness, and I feel so much more comfortable around my family and friends than I once did. Melancholy as a literary boy helped for certain, but it was just a backup to provide some catharsis when I needed it, not something to be relied upon. So I hope that the boy overcame his struggles too, and maybe he doesn't need Dazzy anymore, and he could leave his old friend behind. But no matter what, this is still a song that means a lot to me, and I'm happy I got to share it.